valve?
Of course, I welcome all of our extreme esteemed faculty, and hopefully we have more participants now. I know in the morning when I was there, very handful, but this field has shown an excellent talk by all three great speakers, Popma, Makar, and Kapadia. Really puts into the perspective where we are going with field of TAVR. What I'll do is I'll just take about 8 minutes or so, and everybody's doing the valve, and valves have become very simple. But question is, and complication rate, in my opinion, will be within the range. Of course, some places could be extreme, but majority of the time, everybody has a good results of this procedure. But one aspect, I would say technical aspect of the valve would be that can you come out with a single valve, and what is the data, what is the Mount Sinai experience, and how to eliminate this transcatheter valve in transcatheter valve during TAVR, and that will be the goal clearly of the two valves. And there is a positions a little different. I don't think we need to go further compared to two cases which we have shown this morning. And infrequent complication, that you more than one valve is required because of good hemodynamic optimal results. One thing also that people say, well, if you use two valves, is it more costly? Because each valve is about 30,000. But I would say thanks to the industry that it's the charges per case. So maybe sometime rarely use two, or very, very rarely use three. It still will be charged for one valve only. So what is this valve in valve or TV in TV is during TAVR procedure may be required to attain good hemodynamic results because your first valve is not optimally placed. So it's again the technical issue. Is it too low, too high, or embolized? And this is a particular case. I want to show two cases done at Mount Sinai. This is 85-year-old patient with extreme risk. And you see, again, very calcific, the usual process which we showed earlier. Conscious sedation to pre-close, do a balloon valvuloplasty. Majority of cases we do balloon valvuloplasty. I know there is a lot of difference, some people don't, but majority we still do. And then you follow with the echo guidance and position your valve, start deploying. And this was a 31 millimeter valve where you need to be little below so that it, because it dips. And now see here, the valve is just at the annulus. So what you do, patient has a severe aortic regurgitation. And in that particular case, we change do the hemodynamics, echo confirm severe AI, and then you try to dilate the valve. And this is actually done at a very fast pace speed, pacing speed at 180. And we are trying to deploy this valve, expand further, and see what will happen in the end. The valve embolized. So basically, you can call it a valve popped out. And it was not because of the PVC. It was just because it was barely at the annulus, and now the valve is above. Now what we learned, that you leak, you can leave it there. Of course, echo confirmed it, and then you put a second valve inside. Come now it will be easier to implant because of the position. And of course, the patient did extremely well after the second valve deployment. No aortic regurgitation, and looks a little funny that you have the whole sheath of this stents, but patient do reasonably well in the majority of the cases. Compared to the second patient, I wanted to show also extreme risk patient where we try to deploy the valve, in this same the balloon valvuloplasty. What happened to this? Are they? It was playing earlier, but in this particular case, we actually, the valve was above, so we brought it from the femoral artery. I don't know what this, it should be able to play. So once the valve is still attached, you can bring it out from your sheath and re-wrap it and take it back. And this is what we did in this particular case. Now we were a little more cautious. We were more, I would say, below the annulus. And this valve, actually, I'm so sorry the video not playing, but the concept here is the valve is now a little too low. So what can you do here? That you can anchor the struts of the valve, like here we have a snare, and you pull it up. First you do a balloon valvuloplasty. You see, if not, then see the snare now. A snare is attached, and then you pull the valve up, and that led to the disappearance of aortic regurgitation. So therefore, that the transcatheter valve in transcatheter valve has been reported to occur from 1 to 6% of the TAVR procedure, and it is associated with higher adverse short and long term event. There is a paper from partner trial in JACC last year which shows that many of these patients' characteristics, which occurs in about 2.6% of cases of 2,500, nothing really sticks out that which happened, which case it will happen more. I would say probably with the LV hypertrophy or asymmetrical septal hypertrophy probably will push the valve, and that is the one or two cases has happened. Now, but if it happens, what happens here? TV and TV versus no TV and TV, 30-day outcome, death rate, repeat hospitalization, the permanent pacemaker and all are much higher, and of course higher coronary occlusion, which is rare but can happen more once you put the two valves, obviously. And long term, look at this significant difference in mortality once you have two valves, repeat hospitalization, and non-statistically higher stroke. Clearly, so that transcatheter valve-in-valve is not a good thing and should be avoided. And these are the landmark analysis in this from this paper, 30-day and even beyond 30-day. So it's not only your double valve will give you trouble at 30 days. Even from 30 days to a follow-up, you can see 1.5 times higher mortality on those patients. Now, what is the incidence in overall in the literature? Shown in majority, the most of the trials, actually you see the core valve or Edwards Sapien. It seems to be that with Edwards Sapien, you do have a lower incidence of the valve-in-valve, which is about like say 2%, 1.5 to 2%, compared to core valve, which is about 4%. The choice trial, which randomized patients, there it was much different, but core valve of 5.8, I would say it's one of the highest, because pivotal high risk was about 3.4 to 4%. So that about 4% versus 2%, 2% for Edwards Sapien, 4% for the core valve. So then question is how to eliminate. And I think this is what we talked, and I don't need to go much in detail, that accurate placement, good echo guidance, good angiographic, make your landmark, and develop your own protocol to deploy these valves. And help of imaging is very important, and actually also seeing where is the calcium, how is the hypertrophy, will allow to align your valve and come out with the least lowest incidence. And this is at Mount Sinai. Of about 300 cases, we have one Edwards Sapien valve-in-valve of 99 now. Actually, today was 99. For the core valve is 2.2. So clearly, half what has been shown in the literature. So I just want to conclude that more than one valve is rarely required during the TAVR procedure to obtain optimal hemodynamic results. And TV in TV during TAVR procedure is associated with higher complication of in-hospital MACE, poor long-term outcomes, higher mortality, and higher rehospitalization as compared to one valve during TAVR. Meticulous technique can reduce this rare complication and will improve overall outcome of these critical patients. And lastly, that we know the field is going completely repositionable valve, even when you have a two-third valve deployment, and this is actually happening with many of the newer technique. Actually, even you have full deployment, you can still one of the valve, you can actually collapse and take it out. So future transcatheter aortic valves with full repositioning capability, even after deployment, has potential to completely eliminate this rare complication. And thank you very much.